It is now my pleasure to turn today's program over to Mr. Timothy Blank, partner at Dechert. Mr. Blank, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you, and welcome to our audience. We will begin with our program called Big Data in Capital Markets Investing, presented by Dechert's Data Privacy and Cybersecurity and Securities Enforcement Groups. So I am Timothy Blank. I'm a partner in Dechert's Boston office. I head up Dechert's privacy and cybersecurity practice. I am a litigator by training and trade. I worked on the enforcement side of cybersecurity and privacy issues, and also we do a large amount of work on the advisor, what I call the advisory side of cybersecurity and privacy in the financial services area. And so we're going to share some of that experience and thinking with you today. Our other speakers are John Streeter and Hillary Bonaccorsi, and I'll let John introduce himself now.
Hello. So my name's John Streeter, and I am in the New York office of Dechert in the Securities Enforcement Group. I have been at Dechert for almost 6 years, and I represent clients in government investigations, including insider trading investigations, which you'll see as we go forward here is relevant to what we're going to talk about today. And I also represent clients in sort of compliance matters, figuring out how to best structure their compliance programs. Prior to being at Dechert, I was at the U.S. Attorney's Office for the Southern District of New York in the Securities Fraud Unit for about 7.5 years. And in that role, I worked in the government at the U.S. Attorney's Office alongside often the SEC investigating and prosecuting securities fraud cases and, in particular, insider trading cases. So I have sort of seen the issues both from the private side and from the government side. So I have some perspective on that.
And I'm Hillary Bonaccorsi. I'm an associate based in Boston, and I'm in Dechert's Data Privacy and Cybersecurity Group, as well as an associate in our Financial Services Group. So my work mainly focuses on privacy and information security issues for asset managers and other financial institutions, and assisting them with both front-end compliance issues and advisory issues, as Tim mentioned, as well as managing data breach responses and other issues related to data breaches and information security.
Okay, so let's begin. I'll start with an overview of what we intend to cover. Increasingly, data is an asset that companies are monetizing and investors can purchase to use in making investment decisions. In order to do that, you must be aware of the complex and evolving legal and regulatory landscape that governs the collection, purchase, and use of the big data sets. Obviously, today we're going to be talking about the potential risks and pitfalls of using big data in your capital markets investing. The purpose is not to scare you away from doing it. There is a way to do it correctly and legally, of course, but there are issues that come up, and we're going to discuss what those are. First of all, we'll try to define what we mean by big data and how that term comes up in the asset management world. We will also identify the contractual and statutory and regulatory issues that arise when you either are creating the big data sets or purchasing those big data sets, and how you might mitigate those risks. As John mentioned, we will also discuss a very important part of the analysis, which are the insider trading concerns when you purchase and use big data in your investment decisions. And we will also discuss a very rapidly developing set of legal issues related to web scraping, which is one of the primary mechanisms of creating big data sets. And with that, we'll start with what is big data.
So this is John. I mean, this is sort of a hot topic that I've found among investors is a lot of investors are being presented with the opportunity to buy data sets from vendors or creators of the data and, you know, input that data into their analysis or into their computer programs that they use to make investing decisions. And, you know, on the one end, there are sort of the creators of the data or the originators of the data, and it's things like credit card companies and cell phone companies and web application companies and even, you know, retailers and service providers who have a whole lot of data about, you know, what their customers are buying and what web pages their customers are visiting and where physically their customers are located and things of that sort. And so on the one side, we've got the kind of originators or creators of the data, and those companies are realizing that they've got something that's a value that they can sell. And then oftentimes in the middle, there are vendors who are contacting the companies and seeking to buy that data, contacting, you know, the Verizons of the world and saying, hey, you've got a whole bunch of geolocation data on where your cell phone providers are located. How about we, vendor, buy that data and anonymize it, and we've got customers who may, you know, want to buy it from us. And so on the one end, you've got the creators of the data, which is the sort of the companies who are figuring out that they've got a lot of valuable data and they can collect it up and anonymize it, sell it on. And then you've often got vendors in the middle who are figuring out who might want that data, including investors. And at the other end, if we could go to the next slide, we've got, you know, investors, which is sort of the focus of this call, who are being presented with the opportunity to buy this data and use it in their investing decisions. And to get sort of concrete about it, what I'm talking about is things like geolocation or cell site data, you know, information about how many Verizon subscribers were inside, you know, a Walmart store on the day after Thanksgiving this year versus last year, which might be an interesting thing for an investor to know. Or credit card swipe data, you know, how many customers bought, you know, what dollar value things at what stores over a particular time period. Or satellite imagery of parking lots of major retailers or of shipping lanes, you know, of the shipping lanes that go in and out of Taiwan that will tell you, you know, potentially something about how many chips are being manufactured and shipped out of Taiwan during a particular time period. Or surveys of retailers. Oftentimes vendors will put together surveys and call up retailers, even at the kind of store-by-store level, and call up retailers and ask them questions about the activity inside their stores, and they'll bundle up that data and try to sell it on to investors. More and more, we're seeing that potentially even some retailers, large retailers, large stores, large entities that sell products on the Internet will want to figure out ways to bundle up the data they have about their customer activity, about what they're buying and when they're buying and how much they're paying for it, and sell it on to investors. And then the last category I've got here is sort of service providers, you know, web applications, companies that provide services, you know, cleaning spam out of your inbox. They've got access to your inbox, and they know a lot about what's going into your inbox and about, you know, what receipts are showing up in your inbox from, you know, rideshare companies and the like. And so these are the kinds of data sets, including, I'll pass the baton on to Hillary, you know, the last category is web scraping. You know, there are providers who will scrape aspects of the Internet and sell that on to you. So I'll pass the baton on to Hillary to talk about that.
Thanks, John. Yeah, so as John mentioned, another topic and source of big data that arises when we're talking about these issues is the concept of web scraping. And a web scraping is really a bot or a tool that can be used to extract data and content from various websites. And that might be data that is, you know, very clearly publicly facing. So, you know, if you went onto a Yahoo News webpage or even just onto New York Times, or data that when we log onto a website as an individual user, that we're very clearly able to see because it shows up on the website. It can also be, you know, the scraping of data that is not visible when we visit a website, but that is underlies the data and is in the code that's on that website. And to be able to gain access to that to get additional information about, for example, pricing about airline flights, or, you know, the numbers of times that a certain web page has been visited, or, you know, some of that underlying data that typically would only be visible to the company itself, but that these, you know, bots and programs are able to extract. And the methane web scrapers, you know, detect certain changes or patterns in data through mass scraping in order to hopefully produce what will be valuable insights into or inform investment decisions. And, you know, there are a number of different legal issues that are related to web scraping and that we'll go into in significantly more detail later in the presentation, but a few of them are outlined here, and I think they're worth raising at this point. So one is this concept of whether the information that you are scraping or that the tool is scraping is truly public, or in one way in which it may be considered public or non-public is perhaps whether it's password protected or behind a password protected wall. A second issue is whether a website owner has taken steps to protect its website in a meaningful fashion. So this could be via, you know, limits on the number of times a website can be visited, or ways in which information can be extracted from it or downloaded from it. And the real point here is whether, you know, you're taking steps to, in contravention of those known limits or known safeguards that are potentially put around that website and your access to it. And then third, whether web scraping is expressly prohibited by the terms of use of the website, and also whether you're even bound by those terms of use, depending on the way in which you interact with the product or the website. And then also, which Tim will be talking a little bit more about now, is whether you know where the data is coming from. And this question arises more in the context of purchasing data sets from third parties who perhaps use web scraping in order to come up, in order to produce a data set for you.
We're going to talk about general legal issues relating to creating and purchasing data sets, and then we'll take a deeper dive for the rest of the program into each of these legal risks associated with that. The first has to do with rights to the data that you're acquiring or assembling. Somebody owns the data. Somebody you know, pulled the data together or created the data or compiled the data. And you need to understand who has the rights to that data and whether those rights are transferable to you, and whether the data is public, and whether it is meant to be public before you start to use it. One of the obvious places to look for limitations on the use of data is in contracts. Believe it or not, this is often overlooked. If you are purchasing data, one of the most important things to know is whether there are limits on the use of the data that you are acquiring, and is the vendor from whom you're acquiring the data, does that vendor have the right to send it to you and to let you use it the way you intend to use it. Privacy considerations are always a part of the equation. Privacy really relates to personal information. So are the data sets that you are acquiring, do they include personal information of human beings? If so, do you have the right to acquire that, and do you have the right to use it? And that very much depends on the jurisdiction that is governing your acquisition of that data. There are very significant differences between the law of the EU versus the U.S. Laws relating to privacy. The U.S. is an evolving, you know, the EU has a scheme called GDPR that's coming online in May of 2018 that is very comprehensive. And the U.S. is a lot further behind. The laws relating to privacy are still primarily at the state level. And at the federal level, there is a smorgasbord of laws that apply, which make it very difficult to be consistent in your analysis. But that is, again, relating to personal information. And there's John's, as John mentioned, there are insider trading issues, insider dealing. Is the information public? Is it confidential? Is it coming from a person with a duty to treat it as confidential? And then there are the specific set of laws with respect to the data that you've acquired and how it was acquired. We'll talk a lot about the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act, the CFAA. There are also other state laws that come into play, unfair competition or deceptive trade practices, anti-SLAPP laws, and so forth. We'll mention those. And then finally, I think this last bullet point on this page is the vendor from whom you're acquiring the data reputable and transparent with respect to the questions? And I would advise you to ask the hard questions, the questions that really concern. You should make sure the vendor answers them to your satisfaction, because this is an evolving area of the law, and on whom the responsibility falls is a gray area, but you should assume the responsibility for making sure the data that you acquire is clean from a legal perspective is likely to fall on you. So let's turn to John's topic of insider trading now with respect to the data that you acquire.
Yeah, and big picture, the way I think of these issues when I get calls from clients about, you know, they want to acquire a data set and they want to know whether it's okay, I think of sort of there's sort of an opening question, which is there are two big picture issues. Number one, does the data satisfy the privacy and law of the internet and other concerns that Tim and Hillary are sort of expert in? And then secondly, is this data going to cause you sort of an insider trading problem if you use it in your investing decisions? And I sort of focus on that second one, and I often refer folks to Tim and Hillary with respect to the sort of the first question. And look, in terms of insider trading, you know, the issue is you are taking some information and you are inputting it into your investing decision. You need to make sure that information, you're permitted to use it in an investing decision. And, you know, under the U.S. law, there are sort of three big questions that Tim alluded to that you've got to ask yourself. Number one, you know, is the information public or non-public? Number two, is the information material? And number three, you know, was the information obtained or are you about to use it in breach of some duty? If you can answer any of these questions with, you know, not a problem, you're good to go. In other words, if you can say to yourself, this information is entirely public, then you're good to use it in your trading decisions. If you can say to yourself, this information is immaterial, then you can use it in your trading decisions, although I'll get in a minute to my thoughts on that. And then thirdly, you know, if you can satisfy yourself that this information has come to you and there's been no breach of a duty along the way in acquiring and providing the information to you, or if you're not breaching a duty by using it in a certain way, then you can go ahead and trade even if the information is material and non-public. And so this list here, essentially you need to satisfy one of these in order to feel, you know, okay about proceeding with the data. I want to warn you that the sort of the rules are different in the UK and in Europe under the MAR, and they're different in Hong Kong. And, you know, the critical question I think you need to ask yourself is, where are we going to be trading? If we're going to be trading in the U.S., you focus on U.S. law. If you're going to be trading in the U.K. or in Europe, you need to focus on those laws. This presentation is focused really on trading in the United States. And so I'll ask if we could move to the next slide. And actually, I want to go to the one after that first, if we can go to the materiality one first. Okay, so let's start with materiality, because I told you there are these kind of three questions. My view is, if you are spending money on the data, if you are spending effort getting the data, if someone's bothering to sell it to you, that act alone is sort of proving the materiality of the data, because the legal test of materiality is this information that a reasonable investor would consider important in an investing decision? And, you know, the government is going to turn to you if there's an investigation and say, you were a reasonable investor. You spent a lot of money buying this data. You spent a lot of time analyzing it and putting it into your models. You have proven that it's material. And so I operate on the assumption when I've got clients asking me questions about data sets that if they're bothering to buy it or call me up and ask about it, then the data is material. And so generally we're looking at one of the other two categories to get comfortable. Either we'll decide that the information is public, in which case we're comfortable, or we'll decide that the information was not obtained in breach of a duty, in which case we'll get comfortable. And so if I could ask you to go back to the preceding slide. So on the question of, you know, public or non-public, you know, the SEC's test on this is that the information's got to be kind of widely available to the investing public. And, you know, the obvious answers are 10-Ks, 10-Qs, you know, front page of the Wall Street Journal. These are things that are widely available to the investing public. You get harder questions, and I often get the question, well, what if 100 hedge funds have been offered this data set and anybody can buy it if they pay, you know, $25,000 a quarter, so doesn't that make it public? And my answer to that is the SEC is probably not going to view it that way. They're not going to say anybody could have bought the data. They're going to want to know who actually saw the data or had access to the data. And 100 hedge funds seeing it is not going to be enough, I think, in their mind to make it public. They're going to want it to be more broadly public than that. And so, you know, to kind of revert back to something that Hillary raised, you know, if something is widely available on the internet, I think you can get comfortable that that is public. Now, there's obviously some minutiae that Hillary can go into on that about, you know, what you needed to do, and if you hacked into a website to get it, well, that's not public. But if it's just there on the website and you're just effectively scraping it and collecting it, my view is that's public and you're okay from an insider trading perspective. You got to talk to Tim and Hillary about whether or not you violated terms of use or other issues in terms of the law governing, you know, use of the internet. But from my perspective, if it's, you know, if it's on a bunch of public web pages, that's public information. You're just doing a more effective and smarter job of collecting it up and analyzing it. Similar questions that come up with satellite images. You know, satellite images of parking lots of, you know, a big retailer. Might be interesting to, you know, have someone take satellite images, count up the number of cars in those parking lots, put it into a data set and sell it to you. Or, as I mentioned before, satellite images of shipping lanes. You know, how many ships pass through those shipping lanes, you know, this quarter versus last quarter or something like that might be interesting information. My view on this is, you know, it's just a more effective way of collecting up public information. You know, just as someone could send someone to go stand in that parking lot, taking a satellite image of it and, you know, and organizing it and collecting it in that way doesn't make the information any less public. It's just a more effective way of doing it. And so oftentimes with these data sets, things like satellite images, web scraping, you can get comfortable with the data set just by virtue of saying to yourself, this is publicly available information. It's just I'm getting it through a more effective medium, and therefore I can trade on it because it's public. The last issue I'll mention on public, non-public is I often hear discussion about exclusivity issues. And oftentimes vendors are selling data sets and they might say to a potential purchaser, hey, I'll give you this data set, but if you want to pay me, you know, this extra premium or three times what I'm going to charge everybody else for it, I'll give it to you exclusively for a period of time. And a lot of investors are asking a lot of questions about whether exclusivity makes this somehow improper. And my answer to that question is, this really just is part of the analysis of whether it's public or non-public. And if the information is sold to one hedge fund versus 100, I think it's still probably non-public, and we need to go elsewhere, maybe the duty breach question, to determine whether we can get comfortable. The optics of exclusivity might look worse to the SEC, but from a legal perspective, the real question you're asking is not, do I have exclusive access to this, but just, is it public or non-public? And so it could be that 1 or 10 or 100 people have access to it. The answer to the non-public public question is still, this remains non-public. And so while exclusivity is a question a lot of people ask, the real question that you should be asking is the information broadly available to the public? We could move now to the slide after materiality. So the third question, you know, and really the other question that you might be able to get comfortable on is, let's say we've determined, you know what, this information is material. I want to use it. It's expensive. It's important to my investing decision, so it's material. Secondly, it's not public. It's cell site data. It's telling me how many Verizon phones were in people's pockets inside a particular store on a particular date, not information you could go gather just by walking around that store. And so, you know, it's data that's not public. And so can we get comfortable nonetheless that you can trade on it? And with data that's material and non-public, then the last question we ask is, okay, did you come by it permissibly? Was there a breach of a duty somewhere along the way that resulted in you having this data? And what I generally, and this kind of refers back to something that Tim said, is I tell clients, look, what you've got to do is you've got to go back to the origin of the data and look at every link in the chain or every step along the way to make sure that that data was, you know, obtained permissibly and is being passed on permissibly. So let's use cell site data as an example. You know, I tell my clients, let's go look at the contract that, you know, T-Mobile or Verizon has with its customer and see whether that contract permits Verizon to collect that customer's, you know, geolocation data, anonymize it, bundle it up, and sell it on to someone so that they can use it for commercial purposes. And if the contract with the customer allows that, then we've checked that box, and now we're going to move on to looking at the contract between Verizon and the vendor who's buying it from Verizon and make sure that that contract permits the vendor to take this data and sell it on to you, the investor. And if it does, then we've checked that box. And then lastly, we look at the contract between you and the vendor to make sure that, you know, they're passing it on permissibly to you. And if we can get comfortable that every step along the way, there's been no breach of a duty, even if the information is material and non-public, under U.S. law, there's been no breach of a duty, you're allowed to trade on it. Same kind of analysis for credit card data. Similar analysis for web apps. You know, some of these web apps can sell you data about how many people are visiting their app and what they're doing with it and what services they're buying and things of that sort. And if, you know, we can look at the you know, the agreements, even if they're buried in the fine print that the end customer agreed to, and get comfortable there's been no breach of a duty, even if you're getting non-public information, we can get comfortable under U.S. law. You know, complicated question on retailers. More and more, there are big retailers out there who have enormous data about what their customers are buying, down to, you know, how many of a particular shoe company's shoes they're selling, up to generally how many washing machines they're selling. And a similar kind of analysis here, you know, we need to study the contractual relationship between the retailer and the you know, the manufacturer of the washing machine to figure out whether or not the retailer is allowed to kind of, you know, bundle up that data and sell it on. Again, we're engaging in the same kind of analysis. In this case, we also have kind of a Reg FD issue, as I've alluded to here, because the underlying manufacturer of the washing machine or the underlying manufacturer of the shoes probably, you know, if it's a publicly traded company, is going to have a regulation, you know, fair disclosure obligation under SEC rules to sort of publicly disclose anything material about it widely to the entire investing public. And so, you know, that starts to complicate the use of retailer data. And the bottom line is each one of these data sets is unique, and you've got to analyze each one to determine whether or not you've got an insider trading problem. The last thing I'll say is what I've referred to in the last two bullet points here are really not sort of the current federal securities laws, but you've got a separate issue, which is the New York Attorney General has this statute called the Martin Act, which essentially allows the New York Attorney General to go after any practice that it views as unfair. And even if something doesn't violate the federal securities laws, under, you know, the New York Attorney General's kind of insider trading 2.0 program, he has gone after activity that did not violate the federal securities laws, but that he viewed as unfair. And very hard to predict where this goes next, but you need to be aware that there's a possibility that the New York Attorney General is going to come in and say, not so fast, you know, news service, you can't sell your data or your news feed to someone so that they can get it, you know, a second earlier than someone else. That's not fair to other investors. And so that's a risk we need to think about out there, although I think a lower risk because so far the enforcement actions have just been about stopping, not penalizing people or putting people in jail or having fines for sort of insider trading 2.0 issues with the New York Attorney General. And then lastly, there's just the headline risk and the SEC rulemaking risk that at some point the SEC or Congress or someone is going to say, wow, this data is too good to be true. You know, hedge funds shouldn't be able to buy sell site data. Mom and pop investors don't have access to that. And we need to think about that as well. So with that, I'll pass on to the next slide.
Thanks, Tim. So these are going to be a few different legal issues that are specific to web scraping. So there are a couple of different legal frameworks under which you would analyze the legality of web scraping that you're engaged in. And the first here is contract law. And here the contract would be the terms of use that appears on a website and how those terms of use apply to the conduct that you're engaging in with respect to the website, so basically the website that you are scraping. And terms of use can be found in two different ways. The first is via click wrap, where you're actually clicking through various terms and accepting them in an explicit manner. And then the second is via browse wrap, where the terms just appear on a page and you're deemed to be, you know, agreeing to comply with them basically through constructive notice of the fact that they appear there. And so the main question in relation to contract law considerations is whether web scraping is expressly prohibited by the terms of use, so that by engaging in it, you are violating the terms of use and your implied or explicit contract with the website provider. And there have been certain issues that have been litigated with respect to terms of use in relation to web scraping. The first is a case that I'll mention from the District of Nevada in 2012. And here the court found that there were browse-rack contract terms, but that they were unenforceable because the terms of use were the same size, font, and color as some other non-significant links, and that the website did not expressly direct users to those terms of use. And then in the second case from the Ninth Circuit in 2014, the court also found that the terms of use were unenforceable because the user did not have actual or constructive knowledge of the website's terms and conditions. I will mention, though, that this isn't really the winning argument to make in a web scraping case, you know, to say that the terms of use are unenforceable as to your conduct on the website. This is particularly true when you are a sophisticated corporation that's engaging in web scraping, which is obviously a highly technical issue, and then in addition, if you're an employee working on behalf of one of those organizations.
Thanks, Hillary. So I'll turn now to really sort of the most hotly debated topic and law legal framework in this area, which is the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act, or the CFAA. Just as a bit of context, this is otherwise sometimes referred to as the anti-hacking statute, but this law was written in 1986 as an amendment to a 1984 law, which was designed to protect sort of like the physical integrity of computers. It wasn't really designed to, you know, address the issues that we're talking about today, but it is the legal framework in which this is evolving, and it comes with all of the usual vagaries and ambiguities that accompany a law that's over 30 years old in a modern world. It is a civil and criminal law, so everybody wants to pay even more attention than usual. There are three sort of catchphrases that in the statute that we need to pay attention to and that the case law discusses with respect to collecting data from websites and third-party computers. The first is, did the collection of data, quote, exceed authorized access? The second question is whether your data collection occurred with an intent to defraud. And the third is whether your data collection occurred with an intent to damage the website that you're accessing. Most of the discussion, or at least most of what I think is the really relevant discussion, occurs in the context of exceeding authorized access to the website. And the cases have been working their way through the courts. The Supreme Court has not really addressed it head on. That is, the applicability of this language to data web scraping so far. But the cases that I cite here on this page, the U.S. versus Nozal case, obviously a criminal case, the court held that the phrase exceeds authorized access applies to inside hackers and does not apply to people who are authorized to use the computer but do so for an unauthorized purpose. That case is often cited and is actually cited in the Facebook case, which was more recent in the Ninth Circuit, where the court held that a defendant that is a web scraper can run afoul of the CFAA when he or she has no permission to access a computer or when such permission has been revoked explicitly. The third case on this page is actually an ongoing case, and the legal opinion that I refer to here is an injunction, a preliminary injunction ruling, and I know we have a lot of lawyers on board, but also some non-lawyers, but obviously, in an injunction case, there's no final determination of the legal question. There's a balancing of factors as to whether an injunction issues. Here, the court found that the plaintiff, which was scraping data from LinkedIn, had established that the balance of harm tipped in its favor so that it was only required to raise a substantial question of law as to whether the CFAA applied to its practice or not. But just from a little bit of context, the plaintiff here, HiQ Labs, was scraping publicly available data of LinkedIn subscribers. So that is those subscribers to LinkedIn who had chosen to make their profiles public or certain aspects of their profiles public. HiQ was scraping that data and using it for its own purposes. The LinkedIn terms of use expressly prohibited third-party scraping of exactly this kind of data, and so LinkedIn argued that that HiQ was exceeding the authorized access, and the court LinkedIn actually sent a written notice to HiQ that whether or not it may have had original authority to access the data, that authority was now being revoked by LinkedIn, and the court framed the issue as exactly that, saying that the key question regarding the applicability of the CFAA in this case is whether by continuing to access the public LinkedIn profiles after LinkedIn has explicitly revoked permission to do so, whether HiQ has access to computer without authorization within the meaning of the CFAA. And the court found that HiQ had established a substantial question under the CFAA as to whether it had authorized access to the data. The court spent a considerable amount of time distinguishing the previous cases, the NoSol case and the Facebook case, and the primary reason for distinguishing those cases was that a portion of the website that in the Power Ventures case, the Facebook case, was being accessed was a password protected portion. That is, that the unauthorized intruders reached into what would be fairly characterized as the private interior of a computer system that was not visible to the public. And so that made that case different from the LinkedIn case, and it also brings up issues that John addressed when you're dealing with data that is not visible or accessible to the public. The lesson to be learned there is that you have to ask yourself specific questions as to what data you're scraping, whether the data is public or not, as defined by these cases, and we'll have to await the outcome to decide whether, you know, the substantial question, how the substantial question gets resolved with respect to publicly available data. The intent to defraud is a little bit narrower part of the statute that does not get applied so often. Are you intending to conceal your conduct? Are you taking steps to conceal your use of the web scraper or the web harvester? And if so, you might be found to have acted with intent to defraud in violation of the CFAA. If not, then not so. There are you know, websites that try to limit your access through various means. That is, they try to limit the access from each individual IP address, and there are questions that may arise with respect to people who try to mask IP addresses or rotate IP addresses or create some workaround so that they can evade detection, and I think that would create some liability issues. The third and final part of the questions under the CFA with respect to intent to damage, this really goes back to the original statute. You know, are you trying to damage the computer? I don't think that this is where the law is going to head, but it is still relevant. Most of the clients that we've dealt with, in fact, take affirmative steps to make sure that they do not harm the website that they're accessing. I think that if you are web scraping or planning to gather data from websites in that way, you should make sure that you can show that you're conscious of the risk of damage to a website and that you are taking substantive steps to mitigate that concern. That is, you are not going to create a risk of harm to the target website. With that, I'll pass it along to Hillary for the final discussion point with respect to the legal framework, and that's U.S. Copyright law.
Thanks, Tim. So under the Copyright Act, the U.S. Copyright Act, this is another claim that is historically been brought in web-scraping cases, though seemingly less frequently more recently. So even if a plaintiff pleads a case and makes a case for copyright infringement and that certain information was in fact copied by the defendant, a defendant can avoid liability if it can establish that its use of the copyrighted work is what is considered a fair use as is codified under the U.S. Copyright Act. So in making this determination, there are four different factors to consider. And the first is the purpose and character of the use. And so this would be the use by the defendant web scraper in cases relating to web scraping. Second is the nature of the copyrighted work. The third is the amount and substantiality of the portion used in relation to the copyrighted work as a whole. So if you're only using a small portion rather than the entire work, that could be a mitigating factor or as to whether it would be considered a copyright in violation of fair use. And then most importantly, the effect of the use of the work upon the potential market value for or the value of the copyrighted work itself. And so this is the most important because if you copy a work and use it for a different purpose or what's often referred to in case law as a transformational purpose, then you are not deemed to be depriving the original person who developed the work of monetary value, and then it's likely considered to be a fair use. So two different cases discuss this in the context of web scraping and illustrate the concept of fair use. So the first was a Ninth Circuit case from 2007, and it involved the use of Google image search. So we've all done Google image searches and seen the thumbnails that come up, and the allegation was that the thumbnail images that appear when you conduct a Google image search were copyrighted thumbnail images or copyrighted original images. However, the court found that the use was fair because of the transformative nature of the work, the fact that they were appearing in web search results, and also placed importance on the fact that the use of the thumbnail images did not harm the market for the relevant photographer's full-size images. This was just a completely different use that wouldn't be affecting the monetary value of the original work. And then a second case to illustrate this concept of fair use is one in which the court held that the copying of certain news articles that were obtained by a web scraper but then were republished was not deemed to be a fair use. And the key component there is the fact that the news articles were not just that they were obtained from a web scraper, but that they were actually republished in daily reports to subscribers. So this would not be considered a transformative nature, transformative use, but rather just copying of something that was, in a similar medium. And so the final point that I'll make here is in relation to the asset management industry, as an example of certain ways that portfolio management teams or various, industry professionals might go about web scraping to download stories or content, news stories or content from Yahoo News, for example, and then store that information on a hard drive, there's a fair argument here for the fact that it would be considered a fair use if you are then you wouldn't be then republishing the work. You would instead be, perhaps assigning a sentiment value or trading based on the information that you've gained in the aggregate. And so this, would be a possible defense to a claim under the Copyright Act. And so I think that we will now turn to a Q&A session.
Yeah, so that concludes sort of the presentation part. And we'll try to scroll through some of the questions to see what might be of general interest to the group, which, by the way, just for context, is a large group. There's hundreds of listeners on this call. I always wonder when I'm listening how big the audience is. This is a particularly big audience. So one of the questions we have is asking whether I could we could comment a little bit more on the civil versus criminal aspect of the CFAA. The civil side of it is obviously the side where you can get an injunction and stop somebody from, or try to stop the somebody from accessing your website or causing harm to your website. And if you can prove money damages, you'd be entitled to those as well. The criminal side is the part where the government can bring an action, the United States can bring an action for unlawfully accessing or exceeding your access to the website. This is the anti-hacking statute. I mean, you just have to pick up a newspaper to read about all the political stress around hacking. The NSA code was just on the front page of the Times yesterday. Governments are very, 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 very sensitive to this. There's a little bit of concern that it's potentially heavy-handed. There was a case in Massachusetts brought by the United States against a young person here who had unlawfully accessed the MIT data libraries and downloaded a rather significant number of articles. And the government brought a criminal case with potential penalties of 20 years in prison. The defendant, for many reasons, committed suicide during the pendency of that case, and the government received heavy criticism for being heavy-handed, but I don't think that's going to stop the application of this law in the criminal context. John or Hillary?
So the question that seems to have the broadest application that I see is, has the SEC brought an insider trading case involving, alternative data? And the answer is they haven't yet, and I hope that they never do, that everybody sort of follows the guideposts and we can steer through this issue. But I do think that the SEC is going to be focused on this. I can tell you from my experience, 5 years ago, I knew of, one entity that was using this kind of data in their investing. Now I get calls all the time about it. There are conferences, happening all the time about investors wanting to make use of this data, and it's potentially very valuable data that can be used in investing decisions. And I expect that the SEC is going to catch up, through their exam process or just through reading about it in what they follow in the newspapers, and realize that this is becoming a big part of a lot of sophisticated investors' investing process. And so I expect the SEC will be focused on this, and that if folks are getting data that, was taken improperly and is non-public, the SEC will want to make a mark and send a message to the marketplace. And so it's important to be careful in this space.
Thanks. Hey John, there is one question I think you could answer better than Hillary or I can, which is what triggers criminal liability versus civil liability under the CFAA? I mean, what are the factors that go into whether you're going to face criminal or civil liability?
Yeah, so generally, the difference between criminal and civil liability oftentimes comes down to intent. If the government can show that you intentionally broke the law or intentionally did something that you knew was wrong, that often can give rise to criminal liability. If you've merely sort of negligently or recklessly, crossed a line, that generally gives rise to civil liability. So that's kind of the legal distinction that is often drawn. As a practical matter, the distinction really is one of just, were the facts really bad or not? If the facts are really bad and it looks like you're a bad actor and the government thinks it can prove, guilt beyond a reasonable doubt, and intent to do something wrong, then they're more likely to bring a criminal case. If what it looks like isn't, a careless mistake, or even recklessness, they're more likely to lead that to civil action.
Great. Thanks, John. We've now reached the top of the hour, and I've learned over the years that this is a promise we must keep, that we stop when we say we will. So we will end it here. We appreciate your attention and tuning in. These are interesting and evolving areas, so stay tuned. Happy to follow up if anybody has any specific questions or anything like that. I believe that the materials will be made available, if they are not already available to you as registrants. And with that, I'll say goodbye.